Good morning. Let's stand and worship together this morning.
Can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in shadow, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Oh, mighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
our peace in the darkest day remains. Jesus. This we know, we will see the enemy run. This we know, we will see the victory come. We hold on to every promise you ever made. Jesus, you are unfailing. Our guide.
I built my life on Jesus. Officiated a wedding yesterday. I know I'm a guy and I'm not really supposed to say this, but I love weddings. They're so much fun. But the reason I love weddings, and I was reminded about this again yesterday, actually during the wedding and even more so after the wedding, during the party and the meal and all the festivities that surround such a joyous occasion. Julie and I were sitting there and just looking around, and everybody's got a smile on their face, and they're having a good time, they're dancing, there's music, and I said, the reason I love weddings is because it is really supposed to be a reflection of heaven. It's a reflection of that time where we get to be a part of this wedding celebration. I think the Bible calls it the wedding feast of the Lamb. And when Jesus was with his disciples, he shared a meal. And at that meal, we call it the Last Supper, or the Lord's Supper. At that meal, he told his disciples that he would not eat this meal with them again until he was able to share it with them, with their Heavenly Father. So they were anticipating, looking forward to that time on the other side of eternity where we would all get to share in this great meal together. And it's basically a wedding. It's when Christ Church gets reunited with the bride of Christ, gets reunited with her husband, Jesus Christ. And in that moment and in that time, there's going to be so much joy and celebration because all of the hardships of this life will be gone. Every struggle that you're going through, everything that you're facing right now, all of the sin, the evil that plagues our lives, all of the craziness of our world right now, the political season, everything, that's going to be gone. And we'll finally come to terms with the fact that none of that really mattered as much as we thought it did. Because we will be reunited with our Savior. And there will be a party like none other. There will be a feast like none other. And it's going to feel like a wedding. So as we come to this time, we can share the Lord's Supper. I just kind of want us to get a sense of the joy that Jesus wants us to feel now as we share in this meal in anticipation of that day that's coming, that we will all get to celebrate together, the wedding feast of the Lamb. And it's for you. It's for us, His church. It is kind of an exclusive meal. It's for all of those who have said, I trust in the blood of Jesus Christ to cleanse me of all of my sin. And I believe in what he did for me on the cross. And we remember that moment by sharing in his broken body and in the juice that represents the blood of forgiveness. And so I'm going to have a word of prayer. And then when it's right for you, go ahead and take the bread that does represent his body that was willingly offered for us. And then we'll share the cup together. Father, we thank you for this moment, this anticipation of an even greater moment when your church will be reunited with your son, Jesus, and we can all be together, and there will be a celebration, and there will be all kinds of people there that are different from different countries and backgrounds, walks of life, but all people who have placed their trust in you, and all people who have been redeemed. And the redeemed will all get together and be able to share in this meal and know that it's never going to end. So we thank you, Lord, for loving us that much. We thank you for the expanse of your forgiveness and your grace. We just want to remember that now in Jesus' name. Share the cup together. If you came today prepared to give your tithes and offerings, first of all, I want to say thank you for generously and financially supporting the ministry of Monticello Christian Church. Thank you for putting God first in your life. There is no more tangible way to do that than giving of our finances, and especially in light of how difficult times are economically, to be able to endure and to do that just all the more bolsters our faith and makes a statement that we believe that the hope of the world is found in Jesus Christ. And so I thank you. Whatever way you're prepared to do that, whether it's putting your gift in one of the trays on the table in the back or on our website or through the app. And so speaking of the app, I just want to draw your attention to this real quick. We created something this week that we hope you will find very helpful. There's a lot of different things that I want to share with you in terms of like events that's coming up that we want you to participate in. Some of you this morning received this little invitation from me. We're doing something, our guest luncheon. We call it Next Step Lunch. It's on July 14th. We would love to have you there if you are new here. Even if you're not so new here, but you've never been, we would still love for you to join us on July 14th. We have a lot of fun. And if you scan this little code that's on this little invitation, you don't have to have one of these come, but if you scan this little code, it'll give you all the information that you need to know about Next Step Lunch. I'm not going to do it, but I could ask for the people that have been to Next Step Lunch to stand, and it would probably be about half of the room. A lot of you have been to this lunch, and you can attest to how fun it is. So please come to that if you haven't done so already. And then we've got a pizza and trivia night coming up. It's a lot of fun. We had a lot of fun last year, so we're going to do it again. It's the same day, so July 14th, kind of a big day around here. We currently are promoting a blood drive. It's coming up on July 9th. And again, I just want to say thank you because as of, I want to say midweek, I think there's only like four or five spots left. So you guys have done an awesome job of filling up the slots and giving life in doing so. But if you haven't done so and you've got some time, I think it's later in the afternoon and the early evening on July 9th. Would love to have you. You can talk to Chris Roberts. She'll be out at the table after service, and we'll get you signed up. And I know if all the spots are filled, but you want to donate, I think they're probably going to find a way to fit you in because they're not going to say no to blood. So, but with all these events, maybe kind of hard to remember everything, I want to point you to our app. And so you have my permission. You can pull out your cell phone right now and open up the app. And one of the first things that you're going to see in the app, at the very top, it says weekly updates. So for those of you that are old school and you remember the time we had like bulletins, this is going to be like a digital bulletin. And so this is going to be refreshed every week. And I think we'll refresh it probably by Thursday. It's going to have the latest and greatest, most relevant information. Click on that, scroll down. Everything that you need to know that's coming up is going to be on there, and all the ways that you can register for whatever events, a little note for me is going to be in there, a little button to give, whatever is most helpful for you. But check this out. This will be your weekly update moving forward. It's always going to be available to you. The app is free. If you haven't got it yet, shame on you. I'm just teasing. If you haven't got it yet, we can help you out if that's a challenge, but would love to see you check that out. So with that said, and the little note from me this week says that I am going to have on stage with me our new children's minister. His name is Nathan Roberts, and he and I are going to do a little Q&A on stage. I'm actually stalling right now because I really don't. He's back with the kiddos, I think, but he's going to be on stage with me. And this is just, oh, there he is. Okay, I got your microphone, Nathan. This is just a way for all of us to get to know Nathan and his family. We've done this before, and so this is going to be like a little 2-week series. And the good news is you don't have to listen just to me for the next 2 weeks. Today we're gonna be talking with Nathan Roberts. And go ahead and come on up, Nathan. I got your microphone. And then next week is this kind of the same format where I'm going to be interviewing my son and daughter-in-law, Seth and Amber Dusenberry. They are back from halfway around the world, Mongolia, and so I want to give you an update on how God is using them in their neck of the woods. And so, Nathan, welcome. Let's welcome Nathan Roberts to the stage this morning. I'm loving the tie. Last week it was a hot dog. Today it's what was that?
That's chicken nuggets and ketchup.
Oh, everything that a kid needs. Chicken nuggets.
Emlyn, our oldest, got it for me for Christmas, so it was
nice.
It felt like a formal occasion. I should dress formally.
I love it, and I'm loving the Christmas vibe too. The red and green.
And so Simeon Christmas picked out the shirt July. To match the shoes. So,
so I'm just going to give you an opportunity to tell us a little bit about you and your family to start it off with. So whatever you want to share with us about you and Chris and the kiddos.
Okay. My name is Nathan Roberts, if you missed that part. I am married to Christina Roberts. She's the one that's actually at the Impact Life table. She doesn't work for Impact Life. It was just an opportunity for her to meet people. She is way more social than I am. I apologize for that. If you see me, this actually is my social crutch. If I hold a cup, I've determined that if you're holding a cup of coffee, you don't look like some weird creep in the corner. So, like, because if you're standing by yourself, people look at you like, what's that guy doing? But you have a cup of coffee, they just assume you're just enjoying a cup of coffee, just taking it in. So this is my social crutch. Chris got it for me so I could be a little bit less nervous since it's more of a social interaction. I always feel socially awkward whether I come off as not. My wife is Chris. We've been married for 18 years. We met at a church in Urbana. I graduated from Lincoln Christian University. Did youth ministry for 5 years at Weber Street Christian Church in Urbana. Chris grew up her whole life attending Weber Street. We met. She helped with the youth group. After a while of me pursuing and her not really picking up on the fact that I was pursuing her, there's actually this story that I don't tell often anymore, but she actually went on a date with someone else while I was pursuing her. So it made it pretty clear to me that my pursuing was not very obvious. So, but it was also free pizza, so she took a jump at that. And then one thing led to another. We got married, and 4 kids later, and a few years, here we are. So we have 4 kids. Our oldest is Emmeline. She is 15. She is a sophomore. All of our kids go to the Argentina Oriana School District, which is actually where my wife works. For the past year, she has been the district nurse at Argentina Oriana. For 18 years, she was a NICU nurse at Carl. So if you've ever had a child that was in the NICU at Carl, there's a very good possibility that my wife took care of your baby or one of your family's or friends' babies. To give you a glimpse into Chris's heart, she did NICU for 18 years, which it's not an easy job. I've heard the stories. I can't imagine. She has a passion for it. Her changing to a school nurse was a big, big step for multiple reasons. But a few years ago, we were at the subway at St. Joseph, and I was sitting in the car. Chris ran in to get the food. I don't even know where the kids are. We probably lost them or left them somewhere. They showed back up. It's like a dog, you know. They just always return home. And as she's in line, she gets to the end to pay, and she starts talking to someone. And like I said, she's more social than me, so that isn't surprising. But then there's this gentleman that walks up, and he joins in the conversation. And this goes on for a few minutes, and I'm just curious because I don't recognize him. Not that I know everybody that she knows, but... And the next thing you know, her and the woman hug. And then Chris comes out to the van, and she's crying. And I'm just trying to figure out, who in the world is this person that you walked into at a subway and now you come out to the vehicle crying? Well, it was a parent of a baby that she had taken care of in the NICU. But it was during COVID. And during COVID, only the mom and the dad were allowed into the hospital. And sadly, this baby passed away. And so the only people that had ever met this child was the mom and the dad and any of the staff members that took care of the baby. And Chris took a moment at this subway to acknowledge this child's life to these parents. I knew your son. He was beautiful. I remember him. I just want you to know I knew him. And she comes out to the van and shares that. She says it's often the same with families that have had a miscarriage. There's just an acknowledgement of life that we miss because no one got to meet the child. And so here Chris is at a subway just picking up dinner, and she's making an impact on someone's life just with the simple acknowledgement of a child that they lost that no one else had met. And so there's just this heart for people. She loves to have people over. She's very hospitable. which draws me way out of my comfort zone. But I chose to marry her, so here we are. I like to joke a lot. I like to throw in some deadpan, so if you're always wondering, like, what's going on, I'm just trying to be funny and cut the social awkwardness that I possess. Our oldest daughter is Emily. She's a sophomore in high school. She loves sports. She definitely loves track. She high jumps, runs the 400, does long jump. She qualified for state for 3 events this year in track. She placed 3rd in the high jump. She was selected for the News Gazette All-Area Track and Field First Team as a freshman. I mean, just, but beyond that, she's just an amazing person. She, every parent, teacher-parent conference we've been to, her teacher's always saying she's always looking around trying to find people to help. She's always trying to find the person that's struggling or the person who needs guidance or assistance, and that's Emily. She would finish her work, and she would go. I mean, that's what she's doing now. She's back there helping me because today was a little rough of a Sunday because I spent all week at church camp, so trying to get the teachers lined up and not meeting everyone, and everyone showed up, but she was back there beforehand making sure that I could be a little bit more calm walking out here. Our second child is Simeon. Simeon is 12, soon to be 13. He'll be an 8th grader. He loves sports. We always joke that he's either going to be a stand-up comedian or he's going to be a sports commentator, like just stats and figures and numbers. He loves music, but he doesn't want to do music. He wants to do sports, and I keep telling him, forget about the sports. I'm 43 and I can't do sports anymore. I do like music that you can still do when you're older in age. But he doesn't want it. He can hear songs one time and know the lyrics, sing them. No, he had a very in-depth conversation with his music teacher last year about the band Queen, because the teacher said this song was by Queen. He said that actually wasn't by Queen, that was by this other band. And we got the email saying he's argumentative but also very knowledgeable. Which is true in both instances. He's very argumentative, but that's just because he wants what's right to be right, which I think will come in very handy later in life when it comes to being a disciple of Jesus. What is right, and there's no arguing it, even if he would. Our third child is Samuel. Samuel is 10. He is our fix it, I want to work with my hands. A few years ago for Christmas, his younger brother got one of those like cheap light up, they almost look like an iPad, but it's not. You just color on it with the fancy markers and they kind of glow and they look nice. Well, Samuel found a screwdriver and took it apart 2 weeks after Christmas because he wanted to see how it worked. Unfortunately, he couldn't figure out how to put it back together, and Solomon was in tears because his Christmas toy was ruined. Samuel's decided he's not going to college, he's going into construction. For most of his young life, his goal in life was just to be a dad. That's all he wanted to do, is be a dad. And now he wants to do construction, so it's like, go for it, buddy. So he's great with his hands. He wants to figure out how things work. If he was in here right now, he would be looking at the screens and looking at everything, trying to figure out how it all was working without wires and where it went. And then he would think he would know and tell you how it is. And then our youngest, Solomon, is 7. He is our little firecracker. He's our politician, if you will. He likes to go and meet people. He likes to shake hands. He likes to go to McDonald's and see people sitting across the room and go talk to them, just start up a conversation. For the talent show this past spring, he did jokes. So everyone else wanted to sing and dance and whatever else, and he wanted to tell jokes for his talent show routine. So he's fun. He doesn't know a stranger. He's more like his mom in that way. But that's us.
Yeah. Well, the takeaway from this is you're just a little bit proud of your family, and as it should be. So I feel like we know him a lot better now. And yes, I especially your youngest, he has really become interested in several things in my office. And so what's this? Pretty cool, my Bob Ross collection and stuff. And
he's become a Bob Ross fan because of you.
That's okay.
Because we did the dinner at their house that first Sunday.
That's okay. What was the greatest influence toward faith in your life growing up?
My parents. My dad's a minister. He's been a preacher for over 50 years. And so just growing up, seeing his life, there was no known hypocrisy. He wasn't one person during the week and someone else Sunday morning when he preached. What he preached is what he lived. So, and then I also had other family members that attended Lincoln and were a big part of my life, and then my mom. So I've grown up in the church. I've never had moments of doubt, fortunately. And so just watching my parents, and then just, I knew at a young age I wanted to do some form of ministry.
Yeah. Just a little trivia. So it's such a small world. Not only did Nathan and Chris they live right down the road. We're searching the nation looking for a children's minister, and the one we hire is in the next town over. But as it turns out, Julie and I know his entire family, and we've known them for many, many years. In fact, his aunt used to babysit our two oldest kids when we lived in Sullivan, Indiana. So I know he comes from good stock, good family, all servants of the Lord. So I'm just really confident that you're going to follow in their footsteps. Let me ask you this question, and kind of piggybacking off this notion that, and you may not know this, in the church staffing environment, because of so many of our Bible colleges having to close their doors, churches, you know, several years ago really slowed down in sending students to Bible colleges, and that really hurt, you know, obviously their mission, their bottom line. And so they've had to either, you know, Bible colleges either had to transition to do something different, or they've just closed their doors. And so the ministry pipeline, those people who are going into full-time ministry, has almost dried up. And so there are several churches, in particular in the Midwest, that they just can't find one or more ministry staff positions, and they're just trying to limp along. And so we really felt that, you know, we might be facing a gap for some time. And so our leadership, you know, we're trying to put our heads together and think of, you know, what are we going to do in that gap time? And so, but Nathan comes along, and the question I have for you is, when what motivates you to get up another day, to come to the office another day, to do children's ministry or any kind of ministry, when so many people have just, you know, for different reasons, and not being judgmental, I understand there are some legitimate reasons why people have decided that ministry is no longer for them. But what motivates you to do this one more day when so many people have said, enough, I'm done, I'm out?
I think it can be summed up in the story of the prodigal son. A couple years ago, a preacher preached on it, and he's talked about how as a church, the father goes out every day and looks for the son to return. But he said, also as a church, we need to be out there with signs pointing the way back to the Father, and how we need to be instrumental in that of bringing people back to church. And as I was reading that passage, something that I hadn't noticed before, or maybe I'd forgotten, but it says, as the son was feeding the pigs, as he was looking at their food and he was desiring it, it says he came to his senses. And he realized that his father's hired hands had it better than he had. But there's a moment that it says he came to his senses. And I realized that with children, most of them, as they grow older, leave the church. I think the statistic is after high school, 80% of kids who grew up in the church leave the church. But we never know at what point in their life that they will come to their senses. And the question that I had was, when they come to their senses, do they thank church? Is church the place that I should go back to? Because many of us have been hurt by churches. I was in ministry for 5 years. I was deeply hurt. I got out of ministry and promised I would never do paid ministry again. I would only volunteer. Well, God had other plans. But we've all been hurt. But when we come to our senses, have we lived our lives for other people, and especially for the children, that when they become adults and they come to their senses, that they go, you know what? I remember church. I remember church being a good place. I remember church being a fun place. I remember being a church that I wanted to go to on Sunday. Are we giving children that experience? And so that's why I get up every day and I stay faithful. That's why I desire to work with children so they can have those memories, to understand that each child is unique and each child has their personalities and even their quirks and their struggles. But to give them a glimpse so when they come to their senses that they want to come back to the Father and they want to come back to the body of Christ because it was a positive experience even though they may have been hurt along the way. And so that's what drives me. That's what allows me to do ministry, for every day to wake up and just go, this, I am just trying to point people back to the Father.
That's good. That's really good. Related to that, from your point of view, then what is the role of a children's minister?
To come alongside parents. It's not the responsibility to completely grow the child spiritually in their faith, but I think it's to come along parents to make their job a little bit easier. It's tough being a parent, and it's not just because of the time that we live in. It's always been tough to be a parent. So to equip parents in a way, because maybe you don't necessarily have the Bible knowledge that you think, to answer some of the deeper questions that your kids may be asking, but to come alongside and to just to go, okay, you can trust them with me, and I will help push them along spiritually in accordance with what your plans are. Because we read in Deuteronomy, when God talks to the Israelites, he tells Moses to tell the families to talk about me. As you're walking down the road, as you're laying down at night, when you're having your meals, have that time together to discuss me. And honestly, I don't have enough time during the week with your kids to make that great of an impact that parents have. But I will support you 100%. If you're struggling, you can come to me. If your child needs a little redirection, I will be there to help redirect in the way that you want them redirected. I'm not one of those people that thinks they have it all figured out. I don't contradict parents. A few weeks ago, we had a kid that wasn't wanting to leave, and he was kicking the ball around, and the person trying to get him to go was just struggling, and I just simply asked for the ball and said, hey, you need to listen. It wasn't much, but sometimes that outside influence, because sometimes as parents, we feel like we may be beating our heads on the wall, and then the child comes home and goes, oh, guess what, I learned this, and you're like, I've been saying that for years, it feels like. But as a parent, to be able to push our pride aside and go, you know what, I'm going to have someone else step in. I'm going to have someone else with some guidance to mature them. And it's okay if they're telling something that I've been telling my child for decades, because the end goal is eternity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so one of the things that intrigued me about your family is when I heard that you wanted to come here and be the children's minister, and I learned that, you know, you've got four very active kids. At least one of them is really involved in sports. I thought, what a great opportunity for just a regular family that, you know, you guys are in the thick of it. We used to be, not so much anymore. And so, you know, it's harder for us to relate because of where we're at. But I'm like, I thought, what a great opportunity for Monticello Christian Church to be able to have this family in our midst, to see another family that has to figure it out. How do you balance everything else that you guys have got going on, but yet maintain that spiritual priority in your home? And so that, and I'm just going to put you on the spot. How do you as a family find that balance, and how do you maintain that sense of spiritual maturity and development as the priority in your family? So it's not how should other people do it. How does Nathan and Christina Roberts do it in your home?
That goes back to our philosophy of parenting. We have two things that we want our kids to know when they move out of our house. and that is we want them to be financially educated. We talk about money with them. They know how much we make. They know how much bills are. They know how much money we have saved. We want them to walk out of the house knowing financials, knowing how to budget, knowing how to live below their means. I mean, all of that important stuff. And the second, more important, is we want our children to be spiritually educated. We want them to be biblically educated. And so everything that we do, every decision that we make is rooted in those two things. And so even though our children are very active, especially Emlyn with sports, this spring, Simeon did track, Emlyn did track and softball, and some weeks we had 9 events going on during the week. And that was, the church I was at in Decatur, we also had Wednesday night Bible study. So we were throwing that in, and it was hectic. But the focus is for them to be spiritually educated. And so everything that we do with that is God first, family second, and then whatever else third on down the line. And I actually had that conversation a few weeks ago with Emlyn because she wants to go to college for track. And so we've got her in a summer program, which is 3 nights a week. But we're talking to her about how she needs to make sure that she's in her Bible every night. And Chris is way better at this than I am. But every night at bedtime, they read the Bible. And not just the fun children's Bible stories. Solomon, we've gone through 1st and 2nd Timothy, and we've started Titus with him. Not like he's super smart and all that, but there's a certain level of maturity that we should always be attaining to, which is above where we're currently at. And so it's not just the David and Goliath stories. It's not just, oh, here's Samson, here's the judge, or et cetera. It is, here's Timothy, here's Titus, here's Paul, here's the lives of the church that we're at. I went through the 7 letters to the church's Revelation, 1 Corinthians, most of 2 Corinthians before we left, Galatians, Acts, stories, books that you don't think that you would do with kids. But I did. Because the expectation should be higher than what we think it should be. And that's the way it is spiritually with our kids. Like, our expectations of them is higher. Everything is filtered through how does the Bible weigh against what we're doing. God's the ultimate authority, so how I live my life and how we require our children to live is based on that authority. When I was at church camp this past week, there was probably a 12 or 14-month-old child that was at the pool and started walking towards the pool, and the mom grabbed the child, and the child started throwing a massive fit. What was interesting in that moment is the mother didn't put the child down and say, okay, fine, you want your way, go jump in the water. The mother dealt with the fit because it was the right thing to do. Oftentimes, we're not willing to put up with that fit in our kids because we don't want to have that fight. And so we allow our kids to kind of start to deviate away from God towards what the Bible teaches. Go, okay, fine, I don't want to have that fight with you, child, so do whatever. But the reality is, all of us, it's a sink or swim when we talk about eternity. We either let our child just fall into the pool and go, well, that's what they wanted to do. Or we save them and say, you know what, I'll put up with this fight because this is what God wants for our lives. It's not easy to do, but it is the right and best choice.
Yeah. There's some nuggets in there. Remember that or write that down. The one takeaway, we don't want to deal with the fit because we don't want to deal with the fight later. We've been there. I think a lot of us have been there. So it's worth sometimes dealing with the fit, even though we had to go through the fight. It happens. And then the other thing that my takeaway with this, listening to you, is so many of us as parents, we feel like it's just so overwhelming, everything that we think our children need to learn spiritually. And so therefore, we don't do any of it, you know, or because we don't understand a Bible book, like really the 7 letters of the 7 churches in Revelation.
Yeah.
I'm impressed. Okay.
Thanks.
We don't do any of it because maybe we don't get it or think we understand. But when we fail to do anything like this, we're not giving God anything to work with. And so if maybe we would just take an opportunity, it's like, okay, I'm going to admit on the front end of this, I don't understand everything that this book or this letter is about, but we're going to read through it. And then you're trusting God to multiply or add to your efforts. We have no idea what our kids actually retain as we are just a little bit more intentional with that. And I go back to the study that came out a few years ago that, you know, in the middle of this mental health crisis that talked about the kids who have a church community that they are attached to exponentially do better than kids that don't have any kind of a connection with the church. And so we are committed here of making sure that your child has an opportunity at any age to have a healthy church faith community. And you know, it's okay. Maybe you attend here. Maybe your kids go to some other, you know, youth group. That's fine. Just make sure that they're attached somewhere, that they've got a group of friends that know, you know, that want to know Christ, that want to grow in their relationship with Christ. And we'll talk about the other church stuff later. But again, it's just being intentional and then letting God, you know, be, you know, multiply our efforts. What are you most looking forward to as the children's minister of Monticello Christian Church in the coming year or two?
Building on what's already here, the legacy that Lynn has left, building on that, to take what she had and just continue to advance the children to the point of when they step into junior high that they're a little more biblically equipped. To dive a little bit deeper and not just fun, but biblical literacy. So I think there's some excitement. I'd really like to, because I enjoy writing curriculum, so I'd really like to figure out a way, at least for the elementary age, to sort of be on the same page as what's going on with
the
adults.
Okay. Yeah, we're going to work on that.
And that way, the parents, that week when you ask your child, when you pick them up from church, what did you learn about, and they shrug their shoulders, you already know the answer for what they learned about. And so it'll be easier. Plus, you'll get Bible knowledge from Jerry that will help you answer some of those questions as you discuss to help better equip you during the week. If you go, I want to have these Bible times with my children, but I really don't know where to start, I'm going to start sending out emails. So we have to make sure that your emails are up to date in Planning Center. And we're going to have registration cards so I can have all your kids' birthdays and all of that, what grade they're in. But I'm going to send out an email Sunday evening or Monday that recaps what we talked about with questions about what we did, with answers to that, something that you can just sit down, and if you don't have a clue what you're doing, you can just read from. You can just read the Bible story and go, what did the prodigal son do? And you don't even have to know the answer. It's going to say the prodigal son wished his dad was dead and took his inheritance and left. You don't have to read this Bible study. You want to figure it out just to come alongside you to equip you to those moments. But if we're on the same page as the adults, you go home with a better understanding of the Bible knowledge yourself.
So you just talked a little bit about how parents can help you take this ministry to the next level, but I want to kind of press you a little bit more on that. And this is really more for all of us here and those that may be watching online. What can parents do to help you really elevate this ministry to where you want to take it? We've had, like you said, I love the word legacy, and I know Lynn didn't pay you to say all that, but at the same time, she left you with a great, you know, a great start here. But I think we need to know what would be most helpful for you to be able to take this ministry to the next level. And don't be bashful and don't be shy. We need to know because us as a staff, we can't do it all. We don't have time to do it all. Like you've already said, you've basically got an hour to an hour and a half with their kids. And so it's going to take some more effort from all of us to make this work. So what do you need from us?
First thing I need is prayer. Prayer for me, prayer for the kids, prayer for the volunteers, just to be covered in prayer, just that God sees what we're doing and that he receives all the glory for it. And just the strength, because there are times I can be easily discouraged. Like if I send a text or an email and I don't get a response, or I get the, oh, I'm not going to be there this week, I forgot. I make it through, but I can get easily discouraged about that. So just prayers that I can just know it's not a personal attack or a personal, it's just me walking through those moments of going, okay, now I got to figure out Sunday. Prayers and that. You don't have to worry about me coming up to you, introducing myself, and asking you to volunteer. It's funny because I've had a few people already tell me I'm not interested after I've introduced myself, even though I had no intentions of asking for volunteering. But I would appreciate volunteers. I mean, if you have a heart for children, or maybe you're crafty and you would like to kind of help set up some of the crafts, I think something I'd like to do in the future is kind of have groups inside that basically one person is responsible for like the craft, one person's responsible for the lesson, one person's responsible for the game. That way, if you don't feel equipped to teach, but you love to play with children, you can be in charge of the game time. And so, I mean, there's just lots of areas or an idea that you have, not that I'm required to implement it or do it, but maybe you have an idea, or maybe you have questions, maybe you need help. You can come to me. But volunteers, especially since I don't know a lot of people yet, I've got Lynn planned out the whole summer with the volunteers, but I'm just starting to meet people, so I don't really know who's supposed to be there. I know the name, I don't know the face. So I don't know if they actually showed up or not. If there's an adult in the nursery, I'm assuming that's who's supposed to be in there. Hopefully you grab the name badge so I can go, oh yeah, you are them. Okay, hi Julie.
Cool. Well, and something I'll say this, when I was calling on some people that, you know, mutual friends that we have, and say, hey, what do you think about Nathan Roberts? And these are people that also knew our former children's minister, Lynn Peters. And they said, you know, we realized you had somebody on staff here who was a real pro, a veteran in children's ministries, did it for over 30 years. And the comment that I heard, and this was an encouraging compliment to you, they said, Nathan is not Lynn, and so we should not expect Nathan to be Lynn. But Nathan is going to be an awesome Nathan. And so I would just encourage all of us as we are opening our hearts to a new season in the life of this church, that we would be able to say, you know what, I'm going to celebrate the past, and I'm going to anticipate and pray for and work for the best possible future with somebody that has an entirely different personality style, obviously gender, season of life. All those different things are different for you, but I think these are all awesome things, again, because you guys are in the thick of it. So I am thankful that you're here. In the short time that you've already been here, you've already been to camp, worked a week. You've already improved some of the systems, the interoffice systems that we have, and you're a team player. I mean, I could just see that immediately, and so is your wife, by the way. So after the service today, we're going to have just kind of a get-to-know-you over there in the coffee bar area. Please stop by. Make sure Nathan and Chris know your name and that you're going to pray. At the very least, you're going to pray for them. But if you feel so encouraged today that, hey, I'm willing to jump in or jump back in because I know you need some help, then that's a win. But you don't have to do that. But I would love for you to do that. So just to finish up, I have about 3 lightning round questions for you. Nathan did not know what these questions were going to be. I'm just going to ask them to you. Favorite movie?
Four Feathers.
Four Feathers?
Yeah.
Never heard of it.
With Heath Ledger?
Oh, okay.
It was actually an original with Beau Bridges. Okay. But
favorite place to eat within 50 miles?
Any steakhouse.
Okay, that's fair.
I don't know. We don't go out to eat very often, so it's a little costly.
Okay. Favorite thing to do on your day off?
Nothing.
Just okay.
No, actually, I enjoy some yard work.
Some yard?
Not
yeah, and
all,
I have seen your yard. You have a huge yard. So,
I like the feel of the immediate satisfaction of looking and going, oh, look, I did something.
Yeah, I can identify. And finally, what is your favorite verse?
John 15:5.
Which is?
I am the vine, you're the branches. If you remain in me and I remain in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing.
Thank you for coming up here. Thank you for agreeing to do this, your willingness.
Thank you.
So, yeah, there's those. Show our appreciation. Let me just close out this time by having a word of prayer for Nathan and Chris and their kids and our children's ministry. Father, we thank you so much for just the way that you have blessed this church. Again, when so many churches are struggling to find quality staff, you have blessed us quickly and tremendously. And so we want to partner with you. We want to follow you. And we want to promote you in every way possible, especially through families. And so we pray that you would empower Nathan and Christina to be a guiding light for us in this venture. And again, just as we partner with parents to help them be more intentional with putting you first in their home, because we know that is the way to improve everything about this community. It starts with the family, always has, always will. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks.
Let's stand as we close our service in worship. Thank you. God, we pray that we can glorify you always, that we can always say that you are holy. We pray that as we go through our weeks, that we can just remember how you've blessed us and how, and that you plan to use us for in your will and for your glory. We just pray that we can be humble to that and just trust in you. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen. May you go in peace.